I've been cherishing through the perishing winter nights and days a funny little phrase that means such a lot to me that you've got to be with me heart and soul, for on you the whole thing leans. Come with me and leave behind the noisy...
Who would have thought? It all started in the Daily Telegraph. Noel had been looking for a house in Switzerland and had been about to settle for a not particularly suitable one when he saw this ad. Chalet for sale. 10 bedrooms. 4.5 acres, overlooking the lake.
Weary, living in a great big town. I find it so dreary, so dreary. Everything looks grey all round. I want an ocean blue, great big trees, a bird's eye view of the Pyrenees. I want to watch the moon rise up and see the great red sun go down.
The next day, he and Coley caught the tiny toy railway that twirls up from Montreux to Les Avants. He recalled, the little village was drowsing in the hot spring sunshine, and everywhere you looked, someone had laid a blanket of alpine spring flowers in an effort to beguile. A very successful one, I might add. Then this massive chalet came into view. We had a glimpse of the terraced gardens filled with fruit trees. And could that be an English herbaceous border? The house was a traditional Swiss chalet built in 1899. And although it wasn't love at first sight for Noel, there was, undeniably, something very impressive about it. What was particularly impressive was the price. £12,000. Noel said yes, there and then. He and Coley tried to think what to call it. In a frivolous moment, Noel suggested Shilly Chalet, then thought better of it and decided not to call it anything at all. But the locals did that for them anyway. They insisted on calling it Chalet Couvert, Chalet Coward. It was a welcoming house, Noel recalled, and the owners, Colonel and Mrs. Petrie, couldn't have been sweeter, letting us come as often as we liked to make our plans and giving us huge nursery teas of homemade cakes and rhubarb jam into the bargain. It was a house that invited you to have plans, he said, and he had plenty. Where there had been dark colours everywhere, he had them covered with good white paint. His army of workmen were sometimes a little surprised by some of his decisions. But if Monsieur Couvard wanted the ceiling over the stairs painted red, painted red. We must have big picture windows to let in the light. So in due course, they had big picture windows. Everybody must have their own bathroom. So, everybody had their own bathroom. He had apricot stone fireplaces, specially carved down the mountain in Vevey. And of course his favorite furniture, which had traveled with him from Goldenhurst in Kent to Bermuda, now accompanied him back to Europe and what was to be his permanent home. The wings of life, the Hamlet chair, the Grinling Gibbons carving, and naturally, his beloved Steinway. Noel personally supervised every detail of the renovation. And when it was finished, he claimed the whole thing had cost him exactly £2,017.20. But there was one problem that worried him from day one. The house was dark. It sat in the shadow of a line of huge fir trees. "They'll have to go," he said in cavalier fashion, being totally ignorant of Switzerland's strict conservation laws. So, most of them went.
A room with a view of you, and no one to flurry us, no one to hurry us through this dream we found. We'll gaze at the sky and try to guess what it's all about. Then we will figure out why the world is round. We'll be as happy and contented as birds upon a tree.
A few days later, the Petries dropped in for a drink, and Mrs. Petrie said quietly, "The view. I'd forgotten the view." And it was quite a view. 2,000 feet below was Lac Le Mans, and on the far side of the lake, the French Alps towered. And, as Noel liked to say later, it also overlooks a marvellous tax advantage. Naturally, he made sure that the best room in the house was his. The master bedroom was the master's bedroom. He took up residence on December the 14th, 1959, 2 days before his 60th birthday, and wrote in his diary, "It is 8 o'clock, and I am sitting up comfortably in my bed in my own house at last. The house is really beautiful, much more so than I would have believed possible. It is a light, happy house, and the sun shines on most days. My suite is quite perfect. My workroom is a dream, and feels really shut away from the rest of the house. Here I can sit and have beautiful thoughts. Or not." Next door was a sort of inner sanctum for some very prized possessions indeed. Several hundred books, most of them first editions, inscribed to Noel by the author. Virginia Woolf, Evelyn Waugh, Graham Greene, Charlie Chaplin, Somerset Maugham, Harold Pinter, a litany of 20th century literature. On the floor below, the guest rooms. The blue room. This was the VIP room. They all stayed here. Vivian Leigh, when her marriage to Olivier was breaking up. Marlene Dietrich. It was after one of her visits that Noel had the telephone extension removed. "Doesn't the dear girl know anyone who doesn't live 6,000 miles away?" Next to it, the pink room. And this room, too, saw its share of famous faces. In fact, the guest book for the whole house reads like a who's who of the arts. At the bottom of the house, and virtually built into the hillside, is the dining room. Just as well Michelin never got to hear of it, or the place would have been besieged. Time now to visit the music room.
Orchestra, play, play something light and sweet and gay, for we must have music, we must have music to drive our fears away. While our illusions swiftly fade for us, let's have an orchestra score. In the confusions the years have made for us, serenade for us just once more. Life needn't be gray, though it is changing day by day, though a few old dreams may decay.
play orchestra, play orchestra, play orchestra, play.
Noel's friends found the whole house utterly charming. Edna Ferber wrote, "One rarely sees a tranquil dwelling. I may move in quietly when you are away and barricade the doors and windows against your arrival. That failing, I think you should know that I've enrolled at the girls' school at Les Avants. I'll nip over for tea every afternoon." Noel wrote to another old friend, Clifton Webb, "The house is perfectly lovely, and I can't wait for you to get your ass off those Beverly Hills and come and stay in it. Oh, do come in the spring, when the wildflowers are all a-growing and a-blowing." In later life, painting became one of Noel's abiding passions, and he used a workshop next to the garage as his studio. He was also a keen collector of other people's work, and a journey around Chalet Coward is also a visit to a significant art gallery. Jean-Pierre Rousseau, Sickert, Derek Hill, Hamburg, Clements Dane, John Nash, Cecil Beaton, Adrian Allen by Oliver Messel, Gladys Calthrop by Rothenstein, Christopher Wood, and, of course, more than one original coward. No wonder the nun is telling her beads. Clifton, in fact, never did manage to make the trip. But oh, the ones who did.
On Wednesday night, I went to a marvelous party with Nunu and Nada and Nell. You know, it was in the fresh air, and we went as we were. And we stayed as we were, which was hell. Poor Grace started singing at midnight, and she didn't stop singing till 4. You know, we knew the excitement was bound to begin when Laura got blind on Dubonnet and Gin and scratched her veneer with a Cartier pin. I couldn't have liked it more.
Noel claimed that when his guests left, he would go to the piano and play "I'll See You Again." And if he didn't, they wouldn't. At least, not here.
I mean, it was a marvellous party. We played the most wonderful game.
It must have seemed like one long, marvellous party. A party that would never end. But, like all parties, it finally did.
The party's over now. The dawn is drawing very nigh. Let's creep away from the day and allow me to say goodbye.